Let's all stand this morning. And as you stand, why don't you turn to your neighbor and say, welcome to the Temple of Pentecost. We're so glad to have each and every one of you here today. And we welcome you on this holiday weekend, this Thanksgiving weekend. Has God been good to you? You know that God's been good to me. And I know that God's been good to each one of you here today. We're thankful to see you. There's a lot of people that are traveling. A lot of the Temple of Pentecost family are across the nation, across the state. Some are recovering, some are traveling. But we're glad that you are here at the Temple of Pentecost. Give yourself a hand clap for being here to lift up the name of the Lord. In fact, we're so thankful today for a number of people that are here that were not able to be here recently, and some that are recovering. Sister Mary Turner had a very tough thing that happened to her. She fell. There's a number of bones that were broken, and it was very, very serious. But that happened in the last, before last Sunday. She was in ICU, but God has intervened in her life. She has made a tremendous recovery. The reports are coming in better than what they thought. And then here today is Sister Nancy Adams here in the back. 2 weeks ago, she was in a coma, but God has allowed her to be here with us today. God has healed her body. I want to tell somebody that He is a miracle-working God. Psalms 107, verse 1. Psalms 107, verse 1 says this, "Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for He is good, for His mercy endureth forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord bow their head and say, oh, me." No, can we put that up there? Psalms 107, verse 2. "Let the redeemed of the Lord say so." Turn to your neighbor and say so. Say so. "Whom He hath redeemed from the hand of the enemy." Verse 19. "Then they cry unto the Lord in their trouble, and He saveth them out of their distresses." Verse 20, "He sent His word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions." I believe God's going to do that this morning. He has sent His word and He's going to heal those that need to be healed and deliver those that need to be delivered. Verse 21, "Oh, that men would praise the Lord for His goodness and for His wonderful works to the children of men. And let them sacrifice the sacrifices of thanksgiving and declare His works with rejoicing." Has anyone brought some praise in the house this morning? Does someone have some leftover praise, like leftover thanksgiving? We brought some praise in this house. Why don't we put our hands together, give God praise? I believe God's going to do something dynamic in your life today. You may be seated.
I will bless the Lord. Let's give the Lord another hand clap of appreciation, because you and I both know there's no goodness like the goodness of God. Hallelujah. You may be seated. We want to take the opportunity to welcome you to the Temple of Pentecost. We're just getting things started. Amen. If you're cold, worship, it'll warm up. If you're hot, well, just fan yourself. Amen. That's the way it is in the apostolic church. And we like to start things off with a bang. And this morning already in the GAP class, we've had two to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Another one has been baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Because this is where the God things begin to happen. And it happens because you have come and God has met us here to pour out your blessings. Praise the Lord. So we want you to get engaged, get involved, and enjoy what God is doing in this house today. It is the day the Lord has made, and all of us have come to rejoice and to be glad in it. Give him another hand clap of appreciation. At this time, Brother Chance is coming. He's got something very important to do.
Thank you, Brother Wall. Turn to the person beside you and tell them, God's been good to me. And the past few days have been filled with thanksgiving and being thankful. And I am so thankful, number one, for Jesus. He is the best thing that has ever happened to each and every one of us. Amen. But I'm also thankful to be a part of this great church. And I want you to know today that you are in the place, because there's no place like the place. Amen. And one more time, we want to welcome each and every one of our guests as our ushers come down. Such a blessing to be a part of the kingdom of God in this great church. And God has been good to each and every one of us. And I was thinking this morning, when you look back over your life, you will never, ever find a place where God has not been good to you. You may be look back through a trial and look back through some trouble, but you'll realize, hey, the hand of God was there. The hand of God was there and is on my life. I'm reminded of David in the Bible, where he is conversing with Saul, and he says, Saul tells him, you can't take this giant. He says, well, I've got a testimony of when I took a lion and a bear, because God's been good to me. Amen. Amen. And when God has been good to you and you can stand on your testimony, you have something to stand on, because God will never fail you. Amen. Amen. We have a beloved tradition at the Temple of Pentecost where we recite an affirmation. And the reason that this affirmation works is it is because it is based on the Word of God. How many of you know that this affirmation works? Amen. How many of you know that the Word of God works? Amen. I'm so thankful to be a part of a Bible-believing church. Amen. Read it aloud with me. Upon the authority of your word, I have given and shall be given to me. Pressed down, shaking together, and running over. I am a tither. I bring my tithe today into your storehouse. Therefore, the enemy is rebuked. The curse is broken. I live under an open heaven. You pour out upon me such a blessing that there is not enough room to receive it. We receive jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, sales and commissions, benefits and settlements, estates and inheritances, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, bills paid off, debts demolished, royalties received. My whole family saved and walking with God, perfect health and abundance to walk in divine favor and blessings. I am blessed going in and I am blessed going out, and all that I do will prosper in Jesus' name. And let the church say, amen. 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 God bless you as you give. Coming at this time is our student pastor, Pastor Caleb Douglas, with some special announcements.
Thank you, Brother Chance. I want to join in with those that have gone before me in welcoming each and every one of our guests that are here this morning. We are so thankful for each and every one of you, church family. One more time, would you put your hands together, greeting and welcoming each and every one of our guests here on this very special Sunday morning at the Temple of Pentecost. Just a few announcements as the ushers are waiting on you this morning. On December 16th, 17th, and 18th, we have our Temple of Pentecost Christmas production, It All Happened in the Country. This is a production that will be sure to enhance your Christmas season, and so please begin to reach out to friends, family, loved ones. We want to make sure that we have a great number of guests here to participate in this and enjoy this great Christmas production, It All Happened in the Country. Tonight, there is no p.m. service. We are on our holiday schedule today. No p.m. service tonight. Our regular schedule will resume this week for midweek manna. We will have midweek manna. Our classes will be meeting across the campus in their respective places. Also, we are excited to announce that next Sunday morning and next Sunday night, we will have evangelist Nick Mahaney with us here at the Temple of Pentecost. Of course, he's no stranger here. We love and appreciate Brother Mahaney and his ministry. He will be here next Sunday morning and next Sunday night. We are so blessed to have talented, anointed, and dynamic musicians and singers here at the Temple of Pentecost. Would you put your hands together and welcome them as they come at this time to continue to lead us in worship this morning?
they've got a future and a hope beyond the grave. And every life's a different story, how he led us out of darkness into light.
Held in your hands from the moment that I wake.
I want to encourage somebody this morning that God has blessed your life. God is merciful. Deuteronomy 7 and 9 says, "Know therefore that the Lord thy God, he is God, the faithful God, which keepeth covenant and mercy with them that love him." How many loves him? "And keep his commandments to 1,000 generations." Do you know why some of you are blessed today? Because a generation before you was committed and faithful to him. Do you know why your kids are going to be blessed? Because you are faithful and you are committed and in covenant with him. I want us to sing this again, but I want someone to step out in the aisle and thank God for his goodness and his mercy. God has blessed us. We need to rejoice in the blessing and the mercy of God. Step out in the aisle and give God praise this morning. Hallelujah. This morning. Let's give him praise right now. Thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. I bless your name. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. God, you've been so good. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. God, I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. I want you to look around these aisles right now. There are people in these aisles that the devil thought he took out. The devil thought he was, what he did to them was going to take them out. Some through sickness, some through being hospitalized, some through accidents, some whatever the case may be, financial duress, family problems. But look, they're here today lifting up the name of Jesus. The Christian has the attitude of gratitude. Thanksgiving's not just one time a year, but it's every day to the Christian, because God's been so good to me. God bless you as you make your way back to your seat. Shake someone's hand and tell them God's been better to me than I deserve. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. That's it. God's been good to us. Amen. We have something very special that will occur at the conclusion of service today. Today, something that does not happen very often here at the Temple of Pentecost or anywhere. This morning, we are going to dedicate the Turner triplets at the conclusion of service today. Joel and Kristen, their three beautiful daughters, their families here to celebrate, and we will have a baby dedication at the conclusion of service. Triplet girls, and this will be a very special time, but I believe God has something that he wants to do between now and the conclusion of service. Amen. One more time, let's stand out of respect for the man of God and the word of God, which will come. We are so thankful for evangelist and his wife, Doug Kleindienst. Brother and sister Kleindienst are a blessing from God to the United Pentecostal Church. I'm so glad Sister Kleindienst could be here. In fact, I told him this morning, anytime we invite him, you are welcome. We want you to come too. And we love this wonderful couple and the great blessing they are to not just the United Pentecostal Church, but to the Temple of Pentecost. This year, we have not had an extended revival. It's been a number of years since we had an extended revival, probably 10, 15, 18 years, something like that. And this year, we're going to have an extended revival for 1 month, the month of March. And God started moving in such a powerful way. And I said, hey, what's your schedule like? I feel like we need to continue this another month. So we continued it not just March, but April. About the end of April, I said, hey, can you clear any of your schedule? Let's go into May. And we went in through the end of May. God did some incredible things. How many was blessed by the ministry of Brother Doug Kleindienst? March, April, May of this year. We were able to get him back for this weekend, and we are thankful for what God is doing in his life. He is the United Pentecostal Church Evangelist Coordinator, and so he works with evangelists across our movement, helping them, encouraging them. They have a conference that's coming up soon, and I want you to be in prayer that God will bless that conference, a conference for evangelists to encourage them, strengthen them, equip them, and so that will be coming up, I believe, next week. Be in prayer for that. Also, he has seen probably more people filled with the Holy Ghost than any other person alive. He's been in crusades around this world. Do you have a rough estimate how many you've seen filled with the Holy Ghost? 870,000 that he has seen filled with the Holy Ghost around the world. And we are thankful for his ministry. We are thankful for the great blessing that he is. We want him to come, preach, take his liberty. Would you put your hands together and welcome evangelist Doug Kleindienst as he comes to preach today.
Thank you, Pastor. Let's lift our voices and worship the Lord Jesus Christ together, shall we? When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for me, doesn't it put a hallelujah in your heart? Hallelujah! Oh, praise God for saving me. What a beautiful atmosphere in the house of the Lord today. As we were singing that last song, such a spirit of worship, true, genuine worship went across this auditorium. People caught up in thinking about the goodness of the Lord. all the times he's been there and helped us and blessed us and delivered us and set us free. And it's just a great privilege and a very high honor to be a part of this service with you today, be back at the Temple of Pentecost, and we are very thrilled to be here. And along with Pastor, I'm very, very happy to be here with my wife, and we're 37 years in and doing well. Last week, we had a great time to spend with our sons and their wives and our two grandbabies, and we went to Waco, Texas, and got us a place that we could all come together, had great fellowship, and missing them already. But this is the time of the year that our relationships with one another really come into focus. And if you've not talked to somebody in a while, make that phone call. Reach out. See what the Lord will do. There could be a miracle in the making. Amen. Pastor and Sister Ballestero, we greet you today and honor you. Thank God for your labor of love in this church. Spirit of excellence that is here. Tremendous warming and welcoming hospitality that you always feel when you come. And we appreciate it so very much. And they mentioned a lot of folks were out of town. It's a good thing. Wouldn't be room for everybody. Amen. I do see some empty seats, but there's not many. Amen. And the house is full of people that love the Lord. And this pastor and his wife and the leadership of this church is doing such a magnificent job, amen, and leading this church forward into the seasons that we don't know what's coming, but we know who's going to help us, amen. And Sister Huntley, we certainly greet you today as the Lord's blessings continually upon your life. We're missing Bishop, but we're glad to see the Archbishop, amen, amen, amen. Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 1. Hebrews 11 and 1. It's a familiar passage of scripture. I'll start with this today. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for. You could also say, now faith. Or you can say, now faith is the substance of things hoped for. The evidence of things not seen. Lord, I pray that you would minister by your Spirit in this word through this flawed vessel to every person in this church today. I ask you, Lord, to lift those that are a little discouraged, heal those that are fighting sickness in their body. I feel, Lord, that you will give help and give hope and give strength to the weak. I ask you, Lord, that your miracle working power would find its way to each and every one in this house today. Lord, take this little bit of bread and multiply it, Lord, in our earnest expectation and let it feed this wonderful multitude today. Would you clap your hands one more time to the Lord, thinking about his goodness, his blessings, his grace, his love. Blessed be the mighty name of the Lord. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We all have hopes and dreams. We all have desires, things we're hoping are going to happen. We all have battles we're hoping to win, obstacles we're hoping to overcome. We all have needs that we hope are met. We have hope for healing. We have hope for help. We have hope for answers. There's lots of things we'd like to see happen and things that we're hoping are going to happen. And the Bible teaches us that our faith is the substance of those things that we're hoping for. In other words, we're not wishing on a falling star. We're not just walking around through life with our fingers crossed. We're not just making wishes and blowing out candles today, but we have faith, and our faith is rooted in the goodness that we just sang about, the goodness of the Lord. Faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God. We're not just reaching into some vague idea, but we are reaching into the timeless truth that the Lord is good, that his mercy is everlasting. We are reaching into the promises of God, and I've been told that there are more than 8,000 of them in the Bible that you carried to church today, meaning there's a promise in there somewhere for whatever it is you're facing, whatever it is you're going through. So no, we're not just randomly walking through life, just kind of hoping that some good fortune will fall out of the sky, but we are looking toward Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. And our faith becomes our substance of what we're hoping for. So if there's no other evidence, if there's no other reason to believe, if there are no indications going on anywhere that things are going to work out, you have your faith to be your substance. In other words, the very fact that you are believing God is fact enough to believe something good is about to happen. Your faith itself is your evidence that a miracle is possible. If I didn't have the Lord, then I don't know. If I wasn't looking to Jesus, then I guess it would just be random. But when you bring your faith into play, you bring the God factor into play, and now it's not random anymore. Now I am focused with my wholehearted belief that he's going to make a way where there is no way. He can put a door where there is no door. That's what faith does. Faith, it becomes that thing that you hold on to when you have nothing else to hold on to. They say, well, what makes you think it's going to work out? I have faith in God. What makes you think something good's going to happen? I have faith in God. I'm not just randomly hoping, but I am rooted in my faith that God is going to make a way. That's my substance. I said, that's my evidence. My faith itself is evidence that a miracle can happen. Because where God is, anything can happen. When you start calling on the name of Jesus, anything can happen. He's a miracle worker. I said, he's a miracle worker. When you call the name Jesus, you bring the miraculous into your circumstances. The impossible becomes possible. Somebody shout Jesus. Faith is my substance. Faith is my evidence. Faith makes it possible. Faith makes it doable. And I'm walking by my faith, and I'm living by my faith. Now, how do you know if you're having faith? Because I'm convinced that a lot of what we call faith really would be better described as spiritual warfare. I'll explain. We say it like this. I'm trying to have faith. And what we mean is, there's a whole lot of negative. There's a whole lot of reasons to doubt and have fear and have anxiety. A lot of things to be concerned about. And I really don't know if this is going to work out or not. But I am trying to believe God. And by trying to believe God, we mean I'm looking for scriptures to hold on to. I'm listening to the words of every song for something to lock into. I'm listening with an attentive ear to the sermon for something to confirm what I'm feeling in my heart. I'm really trying here to have some faith. I'm trying to convince myself by everything I'm seeing and feeling in God. I'm wanting to believe. But that is confession in and of itself that you're really not believing, but you're trying to believe. And that's a good thing. Because don't give up. Don't give in to the fear. Don't give in to the doubt. Paul said, I fight the good fight of faith. In other words, I'm going to keep working to believe. I'm going to read one more scripture. I'm going to read that scripture one more time. I'm going to sing that song again because I'm going to keep this up until I do become fully persuaded. So there is this fight of faith, this fighting for our faith, this trying to believe, and we should engage ourselves in that. Because if you quit trying, then you just give into the fear and give into the doubt. And you just, oh, you know, woe is me and nothing's going to happen. And there's no hope and there's no help. And who wants to live like that? But I think we would have to at least admit that if we're fighting for faith, if we're trying to have faith, it means we're not really fully persuaded. We're working on it. How will you know when you actually are convinced? I'll tell you how you know. You'll get happy. You'll be happy about it. When you start actually believing, when it occurs to you, you know, this is going to happen. This is going to happen. God's going to do this. It'll put a smile on your face. It'll put peace in your heart. It'll put joy in your soul. The joy of the Lord will become your strength. Because now you are resting in your fully persuaded heart that God is working on this thing. God is doing this thing. This thing is going to happen. What you believe affects how you feel. I went to the doctors a couple years ago and wellness test, just no big deal. Doctors putting a stethoscope all over and listening to everything, and in a few minutes goes, what's hmm? I need a full explanation. I'm going to need a report. Changed my life. Well, something doesn't sound right. I'm down the hall for an EKG, and then the next thing you know, they want to do one of them ultrasounds, and then they're scheduling me for an MRI and all these problems, and then I'm hearing all kinds of medical language about ventricles and stuff. I don't even know what they are, and this cavity and this vessel and this side and that side. And all I can remember is, And then they're telling me, you're going to have to come back and do a stress test. I said, I am stressed right now. It has worked. I'm ready. Hook me up and test me. The stress is on. I was having a happy day. All was well. It was a wonderful sunshiny day in the 100-acre woods. And now I'm Eeyore. Come out of the doctor's office. My wife out there. How's it going? Well, it's not good. I'm worried about the insurance policy and all the passwords. I don't know why. Every time I get to thinking about dying, I get to worrying about the passwords. Making sure she's got the passwords to all the accounts and all the websites and all the stuff so she knows how to get to everything. And I'm worrying about the passwords. She says, well, do you really believe there's something wrong with you? And I said, yes, I do. They've convinced me in there. And then I got to thinking about everything. I get a little breathy. You know, I'm not really in good shape. Sometimes I'm laying one way or the other in bed. I do have a little pain over there. Every little thing became a little confirming evidence. And I absolutely convinced myself that I was dealing with a severe heart problem and that I probably was not long for this world. And it affected me. I got a little sad about it. I got a little fearful about it. I would lay in the bed at night and worry about my sons and their wives and my grandbabies and think about how all that, and I imagined how all that unfolds without me there, and I'm not a part of it, and all that I'm going to miss, and they're going to miss me, and because I'm a kind and gentle man with a tender heart. You know, the Bible says, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. It wasn't just thoughts. I became it. I experienced it emotionally. I'm pretty sure I told you my Delta story about being on the Delta flight when I was missing the connection and convinced myself my ministry was coming to an end, and then trying to run through the airport and I fell over and had a heart attack and they got the machine on me and everybody's standing around shaking their head and I'm experiencing my death. Sitting there in first class drinking my ginger ale. I'm experiencing in my mind and in my heart, and again, it's the passwords and the insurance, and imagining everything, and a tear swells up in my eye as I am imagining my death. Of course, it never happened, but I thought about it, and when I thought about it, I allowed my emotions to become part of it. I allowed myself to emotionally embrace that imagination. And obviously God has not given us the spirit of fear. And sometimes we can imagine things that are never going to happen. And that can be just the enemy sending tormenting thoughts your way and trying to convince you some medical condition is going to take you out, or the family's going to fall apart, or the business is not going to make it, or you're going to get fired from the job, and all these horrible things. And if you embrace them and imagine them and think about them, they can affect you, and you get sad and gloomy and dismal. But what would happen if we would do the same and invest ourselves in our faith in God and believe that God is going to make a way in the most impossible circumstance? And I allowed my mind to begin to play out what my victory is going to look like. And then I allow my emotions to get involved in my faith. And I'm not just mentally faith, but I am emotionally embracing my faith. Instead of getting sad, you'd get happy. You would feel the joy of the Lord become your strength as you begin to rest in the fact that the Lord is going to work this thing out, and I really believe he's going to do it. And the more convinced you become, the happier about your life you're going to get. If you don't mind me saying, looking at a few faces today, you really could use a little faith. Get a little joy of the Lord in your heart. Amen. God's going to help you. He's not going to abandon you. He's not going to forsake you. He's not going to forget you. Come on, look. Here we are in the house of God. We're singing about his goodness. The Spirit of the Lord is all over this place. The atmosphere is just perfect for a miracle. You could put Ephesians 4:17. Up on the screen for me, 17, 18, and 19. Ephesians 4:17. I know some folks say, well, that's just a whole lot of emotionalism. It's not all in shouting and dancing and running and acting crazy. Well, that's true. It's not all just sitting there either. And I know, and we've tried to get smart, and I'm not putting any premium on ignorance. I think it's wise to reason your faith in God. But I think we need to get back to remembering the value of our emotional experience in God. Watch this. This I say therefore, testify in the Lord, that you henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk, in the vanity of their mind, having the understanding darkened, alienated from the life of God, through the ignorance that is in them, because of the blindness of their heart. This is a whole lot of darkness, ignorance, who being past feeling have given themselves over to lasciviousness, to work all uncleanness with greediness. Last verse. But you have not so learned Christ. That's just not the way we do it. We are not past feeling. And we must never allow ourselves to get past feeling. You never get so smart, you get past feeling. There is no level of intelligence that should take you past your emotional embrace of your faith in God. I love you, but I think it's time we start getting excited again about the fact that we believe God is going to do a miracle in my life. Not just think it. But as we think, so are we. The more I think about it, the more I dwell on it, the more I imagine it, the more I play out my victory scenario, the more excited I get. It makes me want to clap my hands. It makes me want to get on my feet. It makes me want to shout hallelujah, because I'm not in this thing by myself. I'm not going through life with my fingers crossed. I have faith in God, and he's a good God. He's a God that rewards them that diligently seek him. He'll answer your prayer if you'll pray it. He'll hear your call if you'll call out. He'll respond if you'll reach to him. I wish somebody clap your hands with all your heart. Let a loud hallelujah out. Come on, Pentecostals. One of the strengths of Pentecost is that we happen to get a little emotional about what we believe in God. Somebody shout, yes! Woo! Now, I'm not big on Sports Illustrations because I don't know that much about it anyway, but I can't help but use this one. I got to thinking about something. The fans are watching the game, and they're losing. Losing. But their team scores a touchdown. People go nuts. Even though they just scored, they're still not winning. But if you would watch them, you would think they were. Because they just get so happy about the fact that they put some points on the board. Get a couple of guys on base, still behind, fans are on their feet. I got to thinking about this. They don't even have to score. Just recover a fumble. No points. The score did not change. But if they recover a fumble or get an interception, they go wild because it's going our way. Not only that, if the other team is about to score and they just somehow defensively stop them from scoring, I didn't win anything, didn't put any points on the board. All we did is stop the enemy from scoring. Time to celebrate. You see, they don't wait till they've won the game to start the celebration. They start celebrating with every possibility that it's going my direction. Yeah, you know where I'm going with that right there. I asked the Lord this morning, as I often and always do, Lord, give me a word for the temple of Pentecost. I knew I was going to preach about faith. I knew I wanted to preach about faith being substance, but I wanted something that would be particular to you. And I felt like the Lord dropped this in my heart. And you can go watch me on YouTube or wherever they put all these videos and stuff. I've preached about this stuff before, but I didn't never say what I'm about to say right now. The Lord gave me this morning. I said, what do I need to say to the temple of Pentecost about this faith and embracing it emotionally? And the Lord said, tell them that I am wanting the celebration of expectation at the temple of Pentecost. There needs to be a celebration of expectation. I'm not saying we won the game. I'm just saying it looks to me, Pastor, like things are going our way. It looks to me like things are turning in our favor. It feels good in the house of God today. Here you are in the presence of the Lord. There was a sister in a coma 2 weeks ago, but she's in the house of God today. Hey, I'd say that's a little turn in the right direction. Somebody ought to give the Lord some high praise with a celebration of expectation. Just go ahead and allow yourself to imagine what your victory looks like. And not just what it looks like, but what does it feel like? See, I'm not just preaching about what your miracle looks like. I'm asking you, what's it feel like? Pastor, what's your vision feel like when God does what you believe he's going to do with this church? When you see it all manifest before your eyes, when you look out there and you see everything that you've been dreaming and praying, what's that going to feel like? What's it going to feel like when it's one of your loved ones up here in the baptistry and you see them going down upon the profession of your faith? Obedience to the word of God. Come on. Allow your mind to see those words spoken over your loved one. I now baptize you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of sin. And they come up with hands raised, being filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. I need a little water. A little water. What's it feel like to see your miracle. Imagine you're at the doctor's office and they've just slid the x-ray across the table. And they said, look, right there it was, but here's the one we just took and it's just not there. And we don't really know what happened, or we don't really know why, and we don't really have, what's that going to feel like? What's it going to feel like when God restores the relationship? When God turns it around? I'm thinking we've been thinking about this stuff long enough. We need to start feeling this stuff. We need to experience and express the joy of our faith. The substance of hope is faith, but the substance of faith is joy. You'll know you're believing when you get happy about what you're believing. When I think about my miracle, I start getting happy about it. Here a while back, I started doing this. And I'm pretty close to finishing here, Sister Balestero. I started doing this. My wife and I have been trying to move for a year and a half. And we got a big scare a few months ago. That landlady told us that she was putting the house on the market. And so they came out and took pictures and put everything on the market. And we put a lot of stuff in the storage facility and got all of our furniture wrapped up and boxes every direction. And we got the box on the door out there for them to show people through. And it's been on the market for 4 months and not a single person has walked through the door. I started out feeling sorry for myself, ended up feeling sorry for the landlady. I told my wife, I said, baby, we need to get out of here. This poor lady can sell this house. I think we're holding up progress here. I think we're the problem. And we can't seem to get direction or figure out. It's probably just a timing thing, and there's lots of issues and trying to figure out how to make it work and what to do, and it's been frustrating. And I told the Lord a while back, if you just come down here, Lord, and just explain it all to me, I'd be happy. Just, or if you're busy, send an angel. That'll work. I'll be fine with the angel. Send him down here with a golden scroll or something. Amen. But here we are walking by faith. Instead of imagining myself out on the street, imagining myself out of the house with no place to go, imagining nothing working out, I've started imagining the miracle. I started letting my mind start wrapping around, what's it going to feel like? What's it going to look like? What's it going to be like? So what I've been doing lately, amen, when some of the worship songs are going on, people are really praying, I just kind of walk my way down the driveway of that house, the one we're going to be moving into. Walk up to the door with the key, put the key in the door and turn it, kick the door open a little bit, walk in with an attitude, walk around the living room a little bit, walk over in the kitchen a little while, turn a little circle and say, look what the Lord has done. Look at my wife with a big smile and said, did you think the Lord was going to do something like this? Look what the Lord has done. Amen. Ease on back to the backyard. Look around. Think I'll put the grill right over there. Think I'll put the fire pit right over here. Amen. Start arranging everything. Amen. I've started shouting my way through the possibility of the victory. Because you know what I found out? Okay, look. We're just playing it safe, okay? That's the only reason we don't get caught up in this. We're playing it safe. We're playing the what if game. Well, but what if it don't happen like that? Well, what if that doesn't come to pass? Well, what if you believe? Well, what if? What's the big danger? What's the giant catastrophe? I will confess to you that not all of my prayers have been answered the way I thought they would be answered. I did shout about some things that didn't come to pass the way I shouted about them. But when they came to pass the way the Lord did them, then I shouted about that. Because I said, well, I wasn't even thinking about this. This is really pretty awesome right here. So the other one was just an extra credit shout. What's the worst that can happen? We were happy. We trusted God. We believed. And no matter what happens, the Lord makes a way somehow anyway. Amen. It's going to work out in some direction. Why not live by faith? Why not live with the joy of the Lord? Why not allow yourself to get carried away and caught up in your faith? Would you get on your feet here with me today? Amen. And would you make a commitment from this moment forward? I am entering in to the celebration of expectation in my life. I'm going to go ahead and rejoice when it just looks like we're starting to win. When a little something goes my way, I'm not waiting for the final score. I'm not waiting till the game is over. I'm going to get happy right now while I'm in the process of this thing. I think you ought to lift your head up with your eyes closed and let your praise and worship out. He's been good to you so far. Don't you know he's going to be good to you going from here? Woo! Woo! I release the joy of the Lord in this house today. Lord, I pray a prayer over this church. I pray a prayer prophetically over the temple of Pentecost that, Lord, something, a seed of the prophetic word will be planted today into the good soil of our hearts and in the atmosphere of this church, and that this church will enter into the celebration of expectation, that they will go forward celebrating every small victory, every turn of events, every little indication that it's going in our direction, every small blessing, because Lord, those small blessings become big blessings, and all of those little indications all begin to pile up and tell a story. And it's a story, thanks be to God, who always causes us to triumph. There's a victory in there somewhere. There's going to be a victory here somehow. There's going to be a way this is going to work in some direction. So if it's a lily in the valley, I'll shout over the lily in the valley. If it's a stream in the desert, I'm going to get happy about the stream. If it's light in the darkness, then I'm going to celebrate the light that came in the darkness. If it's peace in the storm, I will celebrate that I have peace in the midst of this storm. I'm telling you, regardless of what's happening in your world, you've got something that you can celebrate right now. So here's the altar call. What's your miracle feel like? It's your miracle. You may as well enjoy it. What's your miracle feel like? How are you going to act? How are you going to respond when that financial miracle comes through? Just imagine with me that the Lord answers your prayer. What's that answer look like in your mind? And what's it going to feel like? How are you going to act when the Lord saves them? When the Lord heals them? When the Lord touches? When you see the wind blow in your direction? What's it going to feel like? I'm opening up this altar area today for somebody that'll walk down here and say, I'm entering into the joy of my miracle. I'm entering into the expectation of my deliverance. I'm coming to rejoice and give God praise. If you want to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost in fire, just imagine what it's going to feel like when the fire of God takes up residence in your heart. What's it going to feel like to be baptized in your soul and in your emotion? Come on, it's your miracle. You may as well come down here and enjoy it. When the Lord answers your prayer, when the Lord hears your call, when the Lord comes through on your behalf, I'm just shouting down the driveway and shouting through the doorway of a house the Lord's going to provide for us somehow, some way. What are you shouting about? What's it going to feel like to be free from those addictions? What's it going to feel like to be free from that anger? What's it going to feel? What's your life going to be like when you wake up and say, this is the day the Lord has made? I will be glad and I will rejoice in it. I release you into the joy of the Lord. I release this church. I release every one of you. Go ahead and enjoy your God. Go ahead and enjoy your faith. Go ahead and fully emotionally embrace what it's going to feel like for God to set you free. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, I loose you. I release you. It's your miracle, brother. You may as well enjoy it. It's your miracle, brother. You may as well enjoy it. It may only be halftime, but things are going our way. I feel like we've intercepted some fear and intercepted some doubt here today. What's it gonna feel like, sister? How are you gonna act? How are you gonna feel? What's your miracle look like? Don't be afraid to get happy. Don't be afraid to get emotionally caught up in it. That's the power of Pentecost.
Show me one thing you can do.
Show in the name of Jesus, it's your miracle.
He's the God of the breakthrough.
What's your life look like? Yeah, the Lord's going to make a way. What's it going to look like? What's it going to feel like? Close your eyes and imagine it. See it. See the Lord providing. What's it going to feel like when you go moving in? What's it going to feel like when you have that bed to sleep in? What's it going to feel like when you have that place? Allow yourself to believe. Allow yourself to trust. Your faith will keep you warm on these cold nights, just dreaming about it, thinking about it, trusting the Lord to do it. Allow the Holy Ghost to spring up like a well. Let your tongue go. Loose your tongue and allow yourself to speak in that heavenly language. His joy will become your strength. His joy will become your strength. The evidence of his faith. Touch Russell, Lord. Touch Russell.
He's the God of the breakthrough.
What's it feel like, sister? Enter into your miracle. I'm just rejoicing with expectation. I'm just rejoicing with expectation.
All of my fear I will turn into praise. Shake off despair as I sing out your name. A victory dance.
Go ahead, brother. It's your miracle. You may as well enjoy it. It's your life. It's your blessing. It's the Lord coming through for you. It's your prayer he's answering. It's your life he's saving. Go ahead and enjoy it. Go ahead and be blessed by it. It's okay to get happy about it. You're not alone. You're not alone. In the mighty name of Jesus, what's your miracle feel like? What does your life look like in God's hands? What's your life look like blessed by the Lord? What do you look like? A new creature in Christ. A whole new you born by His Spirit. By His name. By your faith. Come on, you believe. You believe in God. It got you this far. It's going to take you all the way to victory. Don't be afraid to believe. Don't be afraid to believe. He will help you. He will help you. He will help you. He'll keep the devil from destroying you. Look what He's done already. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Don't be afraid to believe. That's the word for you today. Don't be afraid to believe. Why don't you go ahead and take a little walk through your miracle today? Take a little walk through the promised land. Take a little walk through the promised land. Flowing with milk and honey. I see some people taking a little walk through the promised land in this altar. Walking in the promises of God. It's a miracle over the hillside. There's a blessing in the making. Take a little walk through the promised land of expectation today. Oh, Here comes Pastor. But if you want to know how to have the joy of the Lord for miracles you're expecting, just remember how good it felt when the Lord answered your last prayer. Remember how happy you were? How it felt coming up out of the waters of baptism, receiving the Holy Ghost? How it felt to be free? How it felt when the Lord answered your prayer? Just remember the victories. And then use that same emotion for the ones that are on the way. Because they're going to feel the same, and some of them are going to feel even better. And don't be afraid to let your emotions get involved in your expectation. Pastor?
Let's put our hands together and thank God for His touch in this house today. What a powerful word from God. What an anointed word from God. And I want to appreciate you for your great response to the word from God. It's not enough to hear it. The word can be anointed. It could be hot. It could be fresh. But if you don't receive it, it does you no good. Give yourself a hand clap for receiving the word of God today. God bless you. You make your way back to your seat. We're so thankful for each and every one of you. Thankful to Brother and Sister Kleindienst. Would you put your hands together and appreciate them today for being here this weekend, bringing the Word of God to us. We lean on the Word of God. We need God's Word, His touch in this house. And I am thankful for each and every life that's here today that has been touched by the Word of God. Today is only one service, so please bear with us. Please receive the fact that we are going to do something very special. And you can have the rest of the day to spend with your family. But we want to, at this time, transition to a baby dedication. And we are going to move into another realm here to dedicate three girls to the Lord. And we want the Turner family to come. Kristen, Joel, your parents, your siblings, whoever you want to come, your family, we want you to come stand around the front here, stand in front of the pulpit. And we are going to dedicate Amelia Ray, Callie Elaine, and Chloe Lee. Did I get that right, Dad? All right, just like you sent me on the text. Thank you. And that is the birth order too, isn't it? Amelia, Callie, and Chloe. We want the family to stretch out across the front here. And this is so special. This is a special day. If you're a guest here at the Temple of Pentecost, this is not baby salvation, but this is baby dedication. In fact, the word, the Bible says, train up a child in the way that it should go. That word train means to dedicate, or the verb of that is to dedicate. And so we dedicate our children to the Lord, not just so we have something to do. We dedicate them to the Lord because we want God's hands on their life, leading them, protecting them, guiding them, keeping them. And we're going to pray a covering over these three beautiful babies. Would you hold them up for the audience to see, or turn around, let the audience see these? This is a team effort right here. When we had one child, it was two for one. My wife and I both took care of one. Then we had two. We had to go to man-to-man in the basketball world. Then we had three. We were outnumbered. And four and five, we had to go to zone defense. You take care of those three, I take care of these two. And so, thank God for a wonderful family. And this is, Kristen, your mom and dad's here today. We welcome you. Would you welcome them here today as part of this baby dedication? The family that's here. Of course, you know the Turners. The Turners have been the very fabric of the Temple of Pentecost from the beginning. And Joe was dedicated to the Lord. And so it is such a privilege to dedicate these three girls to the Lord. Mark chapter 10 verse 13 says, "And they brought young children to him that he should touch them, and his disciples rebuked those that brought them. But when Jesus saw it, he was much displeased and said unto them, Suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of God. Verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever shall not receive the kingdom of God as a little child shall not enter therein. And he took them up in his arms, put his hands upon them, and blessed them." The very first baby dedication. And today, this is a significant moment for the Turner family. Just like Mary and Joseph brought baby Jesus on the eighth day to the temple, like Hannah in the Old Testament brought her son to God to dedicate him to the Lord. Jesus said, "Suffer the little children to come unto me." There is nothing quite like the emotions that a child will bring into your life. In fact, one father said when his son was born, it changed his life so much. It was a comedian, actually. He said, "When my child was born," he said, "I thought, I will die for this son. I will die for this baby." And then he had a daughter. He said, "I will kill for this baby." And three beautiful daughters that you bring to the Lord today, it's so important that you bring them to God, because they must be brought, it must be taught, and it must be caught. You've done that step. You brought them here, and then your job is to teach them, and then they must catch it. Every parent should have a dream for their children, like Isaiah put this way, Isaiah 54:13, and this goes right along with the message preached today. Every victory you need to celebrate. Isaiah 54:13, "And all thy children shall be taught of the Lord, and great shall be the peace of thy children." In other words, "And all your children will be taught of the Lord, and the well-being of your children will be great." So three things quickly to consider, and then we're going to move to prayer here. You announce what you want your children to be by what you teach them. It's not the church's responsibility to teach them. It's your responsibility to teach them God's word. The church is here to assist, but the primary teacher and responsibility falls with the parents. Number two, you announce what you want your children to be by the example that you set for them. And I thank you for setting this example. We're putting God first in our children's life at the very beginning. Will you give them a great hand clap for that? Everything else in life is secondary. God is first in our life. And then you announce what you want your children to be by the plans that you make for them. I know the plans that God has for them, but His plans must be your plans. And so we bring these babies today to the house of God, and we want to dedicate them. We're going to pray for them, that God would touch them and keep them. I'm going to anoint each one of them, and then I want the church to stand. Would you stand? Look at these beautiful babies. This is something else. And they're doing so good. They act like they're professionals at this. There's just no big deal here. No big deal. I want you to place your hands towards these three girls, and let's pray that God's anointing, blessing, and favor would be upon them. You don't know what they will do for God. You don't know what they will become for the kingdom of God. And we're believing God to bring great blessing on them. In the name of Jesus, I pray for these babies right now. I pray for your touch, Lord. I pray for your strength. I pray for your anointing upon them, Lord, that you would touch them. I pray for a prayer covering over each one of them. Keep them safe from harm, injury, accident, danger, sickness, or disease. God, I pray that you would dispatch angels round about them. Keep them from the things of this world. We pray a prayer covering over them right now, Lord. We plead the blood of Jesus over them. Dispatch angels round about them to protect them and to keep them and to help them all the days of their lives. Let them be filled with your Spirit at an early age and baptized in the name of Jesus, the name that is above every other name. Bless their lives. We dedicate to them today to you in Jesus' name. Now I want us to pray for Joel and Kristen that God would touch them and bless them today. They have a great responsibility, but they have a great support group as well. And I'm thankful this family is here to help them. And there's a number of friends. You look around here today, Joel and Kristen, there's a bunch of people that love you, support you. And how many will commit to praying that God will bless these kids' lives? God, I pray for Joel and Kristen right now that you would bless them. I pray for your anointing upon them. Thank you that they have chosen the best things. Thank you that they have chosen to bring their girls to you. I pray that you would anoint, bless them with wisdom and direction and understanding on how to raise them in your way and in truth. That you would bless them, give them peace, that you will help them throughout every step of the way. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And the church said, amen. These girls did an amazing job. Would you give them a hand clap today? Joel, you're just like a professional dad already. I mean, amazing. And we want to give the baby the first Bible. We need someone else to carry. We got, if you would carry those, Papa, carry those three Bibles for these girls. We're so glad that they could be here today. They live in Charlotte, but thank you for making time and coming and for this dedication today. Amen. God bless you today. I want you to go in faith knowing that the Word of God is with you and that God's blessings are in your life. God has great things in store for you. Have a great afternoon. No church tonight. We look forward to seeing you this Wednesday. God bless.